Are we rolling?
Yep.
Frank Conniff is here, and he did something that's never been done before on this show. He mispronounced Liam McEneaney's first name. Did you do that on purpose?
No, I'm very bad with pronunciation.
With the word pronunciation.
With the word, with everything. Aparna, who I'm not even going to say her last name because I always mispronounce it.
Nunchucks.
She was on my in Cartoon Dump, and I worked with her for like 8 months on the Kamel Bell Show, and I still mispronounced her name.
Well, Frank Conniff is, I mean, no stranger to this show. He has not been with us for about a year because we've been estranged.
We've
patched it up.
On the Tell Your Friends podcast. I feel like Sinatra bringing Jerry and Dean together.
That was the ultimate blow up that led to the patch-up.
And at the telethon I was doing for muscular dystrophy, right. Not to get rid of muscular dystrophy, for it.
Do you remember what Jerry Lewis said to Dean Martin at that reunion on the telethon?
Yes, I do.
He goes, "So you've been working?"
Yeah,
it was very funny.
I do remember that.
Yeah,
unfortunately, I'm at that precipice where I'm ashamed that I remember that because I'm old, but then because I'm old, I'm proud that I remember it. So that's.
I just had the thing where I was walking down the street and I saw a young man with his pants sagging, and I thought he should pull those up.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I'm at that age.
And then you went and drugged and raped some women.
Oh, you're that Liam. Hi.
No, Frank, I'm not.
Well, we're going to talk about Cosby.
Oh, okay.
Telling people to pull their pants up.
Right.
That's how brilliant Frank Conniff is, Myka Fox. Am I pronouncing Fox properly?
Yeah, that's it. It sounds great.
Myka Fox, you might know her from Myka Fox and Friends,
sure.
A very popular podcast. And she's a terrific comedy writer. And this is her first, and hopefully one of many, appearances on... What is it? Who am I? David Feldman Show.
You've forgotten already. You are old.
Yes, I am.
Welcome to your podcast, David.
Thank you, Myka.
You were born in 1908. And it was the year,
yes.
It was the year of the sunrise.
What was the sunrise?
That was the famous war where I'm lost. I don't know.
So, Myka, very quickly, you are. What is Fox and Friends? It's not the same thing.
That is a show on Fox Network where political pundits sound stupid. And then Myka Fox and Friends.
No, that's Morning Joe you're thinking
of.
Oh,
Morning Joe.
Yeah.
No, that's Hoda and Kathy.
No,
that's a Rachel Maddow show.
Oh, come on.
That's not a morning show. Oh, right, where you're on your
Well, I wake up at 4 in the afternoon, so.
Okay, Myka Fox and Friends.
Yes.
And you're a comedy writer, too.
That's right, yes. I
write for Saturday Night Live.
I am a freelance contributor for their Weekend Update segment.
That's fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
So you're a jokey joke person.
Sometimes, yeah.
That's. I have a lot of respect for jokey joke people.
Oh, thanks. You're the first. I'd like to introduce you to my parents. They could use a little encouragement.
Mm-hmm. Well, tell them, because what your parents say you're weak on story? Is that what you're saying? Because that's what my father used to say to me and my mother since I was two. Yeah, that's pretty funny. You crapped your pants, but you're weak on story. Why did you crap your pants?
My parents, when I was a kid, used to say, Frank, you need to raise the stakes.
My parents would just hand me a law school application.
Yeah, that's the thing that they say about people who are truly funny in a writing room, especially like on a sitcom or a sketch comedy show. Well, you're just funny. You just can
right.
come up with a joke
but
when we need one.
Here's what I found from the sitcoms I worked on is that the people who say, listen, I'm not really funny, but story is my thing. But I don't claim to be funny. But those people are not only funny, they're bad story people as well, usually.
They're not funny they're bad
story. Yeah, I think the two things go, I don't know if you can be one and not the other in comedy writing, personally.
Well, this is not the purpose of the show to crap on other comedy writers. But I'll go along with you on this just because I want to throw some flames today. Yeah, my experience, as limited as is,
Oh, no, he's stroking out. What do we do?
You can only listen to the show on the left speaker.
think he might have laughed so hard he legit struck.
Yeah, yeah.
It's David Feldman, The Year of the Sunrise.
Yes. Yeah.
But what was your point you were making about, right, about...
That you're right, that a lot of people have spent their entire lives watching sitcoms.
Right.
And they just know every story. Yeah. And so the basic rule with story, drop the guy. That's it. That's all it is. Take somebody and just lower them.
Yeah.
And then you have a story.
No. Yeah, that'll work.
That's what all writing is. All comedy writing is somebody is at a certain level and then they sink to a new...
Hold on, I'm writing this down.
Yeah, that's all it is. And then you need jokes.
You pull out the rug out from under him.
Speaking of rugs,
like
Donald
in the
Trump.
Thief of Baghdad. Oh, go ahead.
Speaking of rugs, Donald Trump's presidential candidacy.
I'm voting for him.
He's surging at the moment in terms of
weight gain.
No, he's actually looking really good these days. No,
you mean like the way that we had that big Iraq surge, and that's what won us the war over there?
Yeah, the surge worked, and Donald Trump's campaign is working for him.
Yeah, mission accomplished.
Yes, absolutely.
He's standing on the deck of that battleship.
Myka Fox.
Yes. That's my name. You got it. You're nailing it.
Is Donald Trump really running for president? Is this performance art?
Something's running. You know, a flow of shit. Who knows? But, I think this is, why not? You know, if you can bankrupt yourself, why not bankrupt a whole country? Let's do it.
Is he bankrupt?
He's filed bankruptcy 2 or 3 times.
He has.
Yeah.
And he's been given more shots than anyone else in America. So I think he's the poster boy for America.
He's been given more shots than Jonas Salk's unwashed needle. Anybody?
He's been given more shots than Kurt Cobain.
More shots than Chet Baker in Amsterdam.
Quick, now raise the stakes.
And then drop them. I don't think he's as wealthy as...
I think he's wealthy. He claims he has $9 billion, which... Right. And you can just assume with him that he's always exaggerating and lying, so you can at least cut that in half.
Well, I mean, I feel like in this room, if you own more than one car, you're wealthy. I mean, like, you know, relatively speaking, but
does
if you're talking about billionaires...
Does someone here own a car? Are they single? What's happening?
You know, I grew up in Texas, and we had an expression for people like Donald Trump, all toupee and no cattle. That's what my father used to say. I grew up in Texas.
Oh, I was just surprised that there was someone older than you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You might remember that TV show, The Feldmans of Texas.
Yeah. The other thing his father always said was everything's Jewier in Texas.
I used to wear a 10-gallon yarmulke. Yeah. A 10-gallon yarmulke. Anybody? 10-gallon yarmulke. Because, like... All right, let's talk about Donald Trump. Is he...
He really is running for president, and he's actually being quite successful at it, and he's doing what the main purpose of any presidential candidate in this day and age is. He's feeding the media, and the media are feeding on him, and I'm not upset with him as much as I am with the media that just breathlessly writes down everything and reports. MSNBC, which is supposed to be not the conservative network, on the Chris Hayes show the other night, they showed his interview with an NBC reporter unedited for like half the show, and it was just an infomercial for Donald Trump.
Right.
And it was a shitty reporter not challenging him about anything. And it was just if Trump had seen that, he would have been thrilled.
Is there a dog in my headphones?
Yeah, inside my head. I don't see one anywhere here, but I hear one.
Are strokes contagious?
Yes.
Liam McEneaney.
That's me.
Would he be accused of hate speech in any other country? And would it have been more polite to refer to Mexicans as rapist Americans?
It's true. If he were in England and he were talking about Mexicans coming and taking everyone's jobs, people would think he's ridiculous because Mexicans don't go to England.
I'm just offended he's stealing Amy Schumer's bits.
Yeah.
A little respect for the craft.
At least she apologized.
Oh, at least.
Are Mexicans rapists? Because that's what he's basically saying.
Well, some of them gotta be, you know what I mean? In my experience, you know, at least, you know, 1 in 20 of my rapes have been.
There's been some ethnicity in there, is what you're saying.
I'm at least 1/10 Mexican, is what I'm saying.
You have a couple of Mexicans in you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, because my family was raped by Mexicans, so.
Yes.
Well, the Mexicans do the raping that most Americans don't want to do.
And at a cheaper rate.
Right. Sorry. Is rape funny?
It was just now.
Is it? Can you joke about rape?
I can.
Look who's asking this. He has like 18 rape jokes in his act.
You know? No, I don't.
Yeah, but it's not funny.
Right.
That's not true. I have 40. And no. Rape, you can't, in comedy, when I say the word rape or scream it, actually the audience.
You should be yelling fire.
The people who come to see me, if I scream rape, they go, where?
It's awkward because like one time, and I don't normally do rape jokes, but I did one time and it was really awkward because people were being raped in the audience as it was happening. It's just really, just came off as inappropriate.
It is inappropriate.
They were asking for those jokes.
This was a joke. Ray James reminded me. Ray James writes for Family Guy, and he has an encyclopedia.
So he's raped the culture.
Oh, God. I miss Frank. Liam, do you feel left out yet? Because I'm going to just, what I do, by the way.
No, you can rape me. It's fine.
Michael, what I do, and you should pay attention to this, I play people against one another,
right.
And I show favoritism.
Yeah.
And I do it right to the point where Liam's going to be feeling left out.
Right.
Sure.
And I switch it. And then
But he does it to people who don't care if they're his favorite.
Yeah, Liam's already left out in general.
Yes.
Oh, now it's starting to work.
Ray James reminded me of a joke that I did when I was first starting out. I lived in New York City in a really bad neighborhood. All night, these rape whistles were going off. And finally, I picked up my window and stuck my head out. I said, if you don't stop blowing those rape whistles, ladies, I'm going to call the cops. Is that funny?
It made me laugh.
Can I do that?
Rape whistles, whistles are funny, you know. Because Dana Gould says any whistle can be a rape whistle unless it's a slide whistle. So it's the whistle part that's funny, you know.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Is Trump a rapist? I think he is. I think what he's done to you kids are too young to remember what he did to Manhattan. Mm-hmm. Remember Sidney Schoenberg? We talked about this, Frank. Who was Sidney Schoenberg?
He was a New York Times reporter who wrote about the city.
And the killing fields.
And the killing fields.
Yeah. When he came back, this is what happened to Sidney Schoenberg. Sidney Schoenberg, go rent the movie The Killing Fields. You're familiar with that, right?
I've heard of movies.
What happened? What the Khmer Rouge did to Cambodia.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
The movie Swimming to Cambodia was about Spalding Gray's experience on that movie.
That's true.
And it turns out he wasn't that good a swimmer, Spalding Gray.
Oh, now come on. There's some nice people here.
To be fair, he was an excellent diver, though.
Did he ever wash ashore?
No, he was very dirty when he surfaced.
Ironically, thanks to him, now we're drowning in one-man show.
So Sidney Schoenberg came back.
By the way, Myka, we'll explain everything we're talking about to you after the show.
Oh, yeah. I'm just going to spend the rest of the day on Wikipedia trying to catch up. I was like, I've seen The King and I? No, I haven't. That's a lie.
Well, I thank you for, that's why it's good. I know Myka knows who we're talking about, but very quickly, Spalding.
She has no idea.
I have no idea what's happening.
Are you serious?
Yes.
You don't know who Spalding
Gray? Oh, Spalding Gray. Yes, I know.
And you know that he, you know, drowned.
Not no. Spalding tennis balls, Spalding Gray.
Sure, wait, what, tennis?
Anyway, so Sidney Schoenberg, and you should all rent The Killing Fields, comes back from Cambodia with mild PTSD because of the genocide that went on. He's working for the New York Times. He becomes a columnist, and he wants to cover something, go after somebody who reminds him of Pol Pot. Mm-hmm. And he went after Trump in the late 70s, early 80s. He began exposing Donald Trump, the son of a wealthy builder who was taking rent control buildings and destroying lives with them. He would put homeless people, he would go, I'm putting homeless people, giving them shelter. Mm-hmm. But what he would do is he would fill a rent-controlled building with homeless people who shat and pissed, and to the point where old people just had to leave. He has ruined so many lives.
Yes.
This is Pol Pot we're talking about.
Well,
Pol Pot when he was a landlord in New York.
Yeah. I mean, Donald Trump is more than just a joke.
Yeah, he's and also he's, you know, his buildings are always ugly, and they're you know, New York at one time was the New York skyline was one of the glories of the world of beautiful architecture, and he's one of the people, not the only one, but he's one of the people that's really messed that up.
He was behind Westway, right? Wasn't he going to build Westway?
Oh, I don't remember. He might have been. Yeah.
Also, and people forget this, but he said his daughter is so hot that if she wasn't his daughter, he would probably date her.
He said that, really?
He said that out loud to a reporter.
Wow. He said, I've always said that. So that's something he repeats on the regular.
Yeah, yeah, that's something.
Like, if you say it three times, you fucked your daughter.
But he, to be fair, he dated her first.
Right. He's an old-fashioned kind of
you know
kind of
problem?
Incestuous rapist.
Mackenzie Phillips told me, the problem with fucking your daughter is when you say, who's your daddy? She turns around and says, you are. Notice I said turns around.
Oh.
That's the key to that joke, is turns around.
Well, I can't believe Mackenzie Phillips told you that joke.
Yeah,
I mean,
she
that's,
did.
That's outrageous.
Yeah. It's not. We've gone into an area that we shouldn't. Mm-hmm. I'm quoting her father. Trump is.
You know what you take after you've been anally raped by him is John Phillips' milk of magnesia.
We better be careful. I'm afraid of John Phillips. Sousa.
Sousing us.
Sousing us. Jesus. This is simultaneously the best and worst show.
I will take credit for half of that.
No, I'm just talking about my show in general.
Oh, okay.
You know, in other words, it is usually incredibly funny and incredibly horrible at the same time.
And
right?
I think we're achieving that.
Okay, Trump.
He better get.
Is he the face of the Republican Party? Is he saying the things?
He's the hairline of the Republican Party.
Is he saying the things that they truly believe?
Yes,
I think he is.
He absolutely is. But Mike Huckabee is, and Rick Santorum and Ted Cruz, they're every bit as hateful as he is. He's not saying anything that they haven't said, and he just says it in a louder way. And he automatically gets huge media attention for whatever he says, but he's no different from
he's the Eminem of Republicans.
Yeah,
he's saying what they're all thinking in their living rooms. I'll take it a step further. I think he's saying what the Democrats are thinking too. They're all just rich people trying to get a buck, and they picked a side, you know, to win their audience. But I think Donald Trump's any rich old white guy running for office.
Yeah, although because of Citizens United now, the money from Wall Street is flowing to the Republican Party, and the money from the gays and the environmentalists is flowing to the Democratic Party. That's what's happening.
Yeah.
And so the money is forcing the Democratic Party to become progressive. It's kind of interesting what's happening.
It is. And Hillary, has gone further to the left in her rhetoric, and it's part of the whole what's changing in the country as well.
The country's changing, but the money's changing.
Yeah, well, that's what makes the country change.
And that's part of it's part of what's making Bernie Sanders an actual viable candidate, you know, instead of just like an old man, you know, saying what everyone wants him.
Well, he's not. He's not the old. I've yet to, in terms of someone who can win ultimately, I don't really consider him viable.
My feelings about Bernie Sanders. This is what I think about Bernie. Mm-hmm. He is absolutely right on everything.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean your rabbi should also be your landlord.
Exactly what I was thinking.
What? You want to unpack that? I think we went on a trip. And, right.
Wait, so my rabbi is Donald Trump.
You're right. No, what I'm saying is that Bernie Sanders is a brilliant man, and he's absolutely right on everything, but that doesn't mean I want him to run my tenement in the Bronx for me.
Right. I still don't know.
Yeah,
does that
he's not
he
running.
Have business well,
let me try.
He's not running for.
Okay, let me not
landlord.
Do a Jewish thing. Let me try an Italian.
Because
thing.
All Jews run tenement buildings.
Right.
Am I wrong?
Oh,
right.
And then eventually they set fire to them, but you know, so they don't run them. Yeah. No, okay.
Want him killing my baby to make the matzo with the blood in it.
What I like about Bernie Sanders, a lot of things, but I also like that he's running as a Democrat, and he's not running a third party candidacy. That would be destructive, I think.
He calls himself a socialist.
Uh-huh.
So is he revealing the real hand of the Democratic Party? Is it fair to say that if the Republicans showed their real hand, mm-hmm. as Trump is doing,
yes.
He's revealing the Republicans to be the fascists that they are?
Although he's not revealing it, he's just being louder about it. That's been obvious for a long time to anyone watching or not watching mainstream media.
I think one of his biggest sins is actually he's not using the code that the Republicans have been using for like 50 years to say all the stuff that Trump is saying. Like,
although he
trickle down really means rapist Mexicans.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
It's the cum trickling down.
No, but I mean, you know, it's...
I wish that image didn't turn me on so much.
You might be a Republican, yes. Frank.
You know, we should shut the window.
No, but Trump, though, you say he's not using code words. He was until he made the statement about Mexicans being rapists. That was too blatant. But for years, he was doing this whole Obama birther thing, which he's still doing, and which is a completely racist thing. And he actually got a pass from the media on it. I mean, people confronted him about it, but it didn't get any, or from businesses either. It was a blatantly racist thing, and he didn't really suffer any consequences for it.
But he wasn't saying, but I mean, the difference was he wasn't out and out saying Obama's black, therefore he shouldn't be president. He was using the code of the Tea Party.
Yeah, that's my point, is he was using the code. But the Mexican thing is less coded, I think.
Let me ask you about...
Well, it's like that great Carlos Mencia joke, you know, we're not Mexicans. Where Mexican go out and rape white women.
Oh, okay.
That great Carlos Mencia joke.
That is a great Carlos Mencia joke.
That.
So is this a new device where we come up with a really bad joke and attribute it to Carlos Mencia?
No, that's what Carlos Mencia's joke is. It's not Mexicans, it's Mexican.
Uh-huh.
He was running for office last year, and that was his platform.
But he's Honduran.
Well, there you go.
And German. Did you know that?
Yes, I did.
He's a
His name is Ned.
Ned is a descendant of Nazis who were hiding out in Honduras before World War II. That's how we're speaking of World War II.
Oh, thank God.
Is it fair to say this is the difference between Democrats and Republicans? The Sanders, you know, Bernie Sanders calls himself a socialist. And I know Republicans, and they're fascists. You know, they believe in the fascism is militarism mixed with
They're at least, you can say, they're authoritarians.
They believe in the military, corporatism, and nationalism. Mm-hmm. That when you combine all
and an
three,
ultimate race, let's
and racism, right? Absolutely. So, is it fair to say that if you're a Republican, you
are a Nazi? You heard it here on the David Feldman Show.
You were willing to do business with Hitler before December 7th. And if you're a Democrat, you were either sympathetic or a member of the Communist Party up until about 1945 when you realized how bad Stalin was. Isn't that the current root of
I don't know if a lot of Democrats are as vociferously socialist that way anymore, or present themselves as sympathizing with communist.
It's not like
I'm saying that's where the womb, the baby boomers, when they split, The baby boomers split when Reagan became president.
Right.
And I always think you retreat to where you came from.
Mm-hmm. But it's not like Hillary Clinton's throwing Tupperware parties to raise money for her candidacy. You know, she's speaking for $100,000 at these big corporate events, you know, and she's accepting big corporate money.
Right. I'm asking a very deep question. It's profound and it's important, and I'm self-righteous and boring. I want to get back to this because I do think it's important. I think if you're a Democrat, because your parents or your grandparents, deep down inside, sympathized with Joseph Stalin.
Oh, I don't. That's not the case.
And the Weather Underground, and believe that your radical id and the Democrat. Because we always talk about the Let me finish for 1 second. I'm talking about the radical id of both parties.
Right.
And, hang on. Let me
The Freedom Riders were Stalinists.
No. I'm talking about both sides. Can be dangerous. Mm-hmm. The Democrats have a dangerous militant side that, you know, the Black Panthers, they carried guns. That was their big thing. They brought guns into the state capitol in California. The Weather Underground, as right as they were terrorists.
And okay. They didn't really ultimately blow up. But those people never became mainstream.
You can't define a group by their most extreme.
Yeah. Yes, you can, because I believe that if you go on Daily Kos, which I love, there are, and my experience at Pacifica Radio, there are radicals on the left who don't believe in the system.
Yes, but I don't think that's the mainstream of the Democratic Party.
No, I'm not saying it's the mainstream.
And if you go on Stormfront, you know, there's radicals on the right.
Republican Party is just dudes living in trailers.
And if you go to Comic-Con, you'll see dudes dressed as stormtroopers. It doesn't mean they're all in the Empire.
I want to talk about the radical left because they have been hibernating or been squashed since Reagan became president.
Well, what I think, what I see in the among Democrats or liberal-leaning people, a certain strain of Democrats who work in the mainstream of society, who basically are under the corporate thumb like everyone else, but they like to flatter themselves to think that they have a radical strain in them, that they're anti-corporatist. You know, you see this with the anti-vax people from the left. And, I don't trust corporations. I don't trust the system. I don't trust the man. And meanwhile, they live a life that's in service of the man, in service of the system, in service of corporations. But they like to have that strain within them that feels like, hey, I don't fall for this vaccination stuff because I don't trust corporations, you know.
Right.
And I think that that's kind of a destructive strain within the left.
But you don't think there are people on the left. And I'm bringing this up because for the past 6 years on this show, we've been calling attention to the Republicans and their ties to not just right-wing extremists, but racists. You know, they found out with the Confederate flag in South Carolina, all these Nazi groups have been donating money to Huckabee and Ted Cruz. And, and we're all familiar with that on the left. Mm. I want to talk about the radical left.
But there's no equivalent of that in the left wing.
There used to be a very pronounced radical left. That the Democratic Party.
When you say used to be, what do you mean?
I think after McGovern, they got scared. And they cleaned house, and then Bill Clinton just became a Republican. He got elected by becoming a Republican, and so the Democratic Party is so afraid of the left, the radical left, rearing its.
That's true.
But what about a
movement? But it's out there.
What about a movement like Occupy Wall Street?
I used to go to the rallies, and I think Occupy Wall Street was the most successful movement since the no nukes of the 80s.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It was great. But there were people, you know, if you go there, there were some people wearing masks. there were some people.
Are you sure you're not talking about Comic-Con?
You know, when I see people showing up with ski masks and not willing to show their face,
right?
I go, what are you about here? What are you doing here? I mean, there is.
They're part of the KKK.
Well, actually, well, yeah. You know,
there's
a
radical. Maybe they're just going skiing.
You know where the radical left really is now, and the really dangerous element, fringe of the left, is online. You know, Anonymous and all these movements online. Mm. You know, they're saying that that the taking offline of this week of the stock exchange and United Airlines and Wall Street Journal website was the result of you know, radical left wing hacktivists. Mm-hmm. And so that's where you're seeing a lot of these leftist radical dudes now is, you know, on God, I got 4 hours sleep last night, so help me finish this sentence.
You're giving us about an hour of it.
But you know what I'm saying? I mean, like, you've been seeing that pop up over the last few years. Like, these guys exposing the people who run the KKK's Twitter handle and, you know, exposing all their online info. Mm. That's where these left-wing activists are.
Would you say that the radical left is sympathetic to ISIS?
No.
I hope not. You know, and also, yeah, the radical, whatever radical left there is in the country is very fringe, much more fringe than the radical right is in the Republican Party. And also, the mainstream media is very much, you know, if you become moderate, like Barack Obama is basically a moderate politician. He's called left by the media. And I just saw a segment on MSNBC yesterday, Steve Kornacki talking about, is Alan Grayson the Donald Trump of the left? You know, so the mainstream media will do anything to demonize anyone who's even remotely left-wing, and that's part of the problem that the left has, is they're so unwelcome. The right-wing is much more welcome in the mainstream media. If you watch Meet the Press this week, Face the Nation, you'll never see any person that you would consider like radical left, but you'll always see like tons of radical right people on those shows. Right. Bill Kristol is on every week. He's a radical right person.
But those shows, you know, are all right, underwritten by oil companies.
Yes,
too,
right? If you watch oil, the commercials. And Boeing. Yeah. They have Meet the Press has a special segment now. I forget what it's called. That's like sponsored by Boeing. Yeah. You know, and that's why on those shows you never hear any anti-military rhetoric ever. You'll hear lots of politicians and pundits come on and say how we need to cut Social Security, we need to take away benefits, we need to take away entitlements.
We need to teach those birds on the Gulf Coast a lesson.
Yes, you'll never hear any of them talk about how, hey, here's one way we can balance the budget. Maybe we could cut military spending radically. You'll never hear that ever.
Is it because, you know, the Jews govern their own? Uh-huh. It's an unsaid thing that goes on with Jews, especially in show business, and this goes all the way back to the beginning of Hollywood. Mm-hmm. If
it's pretty much the only thing Jews don't say.
Mike, are you Jewish?
Yes.
Okay, so you know that
I am, for the purposes of making jokes at their expense.
Good. If a Jew in show business,
why do you think she does so well in show business?
It's not talent, let me tell you.
There's an expression, Shonda. Explain what a Shonda means.
It's like a shame,
a
right?
Shame. Yeah. And if someone brings shame on Jews, especially in America, they are unceremoniously removed from the party or show business or politics. You have to behave the right way as a Jew, or the Jews will make you step down. And it's not an official, it's not Zog, it's not some conspiracy. It's just the Jews have a very pronounced, precise sense of what is right and what is wrong and how they want to be represented. And if you are an embarrassment to the Jews, if you have like in stand-up comedy,
just like they got rid of Woody Allen once they figured out.
Well,
is this what happened to you, David? Is this what you're trying to tell us?
No, there are messages sent to you by the audience, by Jewish audiences. Don't bring shame on us, or don't talk about being Jewish if you're going to bring shame on us. And I often wonder if the same applies to liberals. That one of the besides the fact that corporate America owns Meet the Press, you do have liberals who pretty much have, I would say, a vast, Brian Williams.
Brian Williams is not remotely a liberal.
Well, okay, I happen to know he is, but
no, he isn't.
Okay, he's rich, basically.
he's rich and he's not liberal. He had a military war profiteers on his show and during the Iraq War, telling people what we should do in Iraq, and meanwhile they were profiteering off of the war. Most of his coverage has been right leaning, by any standard.
He didn't get caught lying about, you know, giving food to homeless people or anything like that. He got caught lying about what a fucking experience he had over there in Iraq, you know, on a military helicopter.
But he didn't get fired for lying, for telling the lies that got us into Iraq, which is his major crime, along with everyone else in the mainstream media.
Do you think the reason liberals are not seen on mainstream media is because the liberals who run mainstream media are ashamed of what the liberals really believe?
Well, who are the liberals who run mainstream media?
George Will. Wow. He's a neoliberal economic.
No, he's not. I know. I mean, all of these corporations.
Catherine Van de Hevel Hoevelhavel from The Nation.
They have. Catherine Van de Hevel, you do see on Sunday shows, she's about as left wing as
Rachel
you'll
Maddow.
Ever see. Rachel Maddow as well.
We have Arianna Huffington, maybe. But
no, Arianna Huffington I don't consider to be a left wing at all either.
And I definitely don't consider her website media. Yeah.
Well, it's all too media is the problem.
Well, I mean, isn't she a radical? I mean, she doesn't pay her workers, isn't that?
Yeah, that's pretty radical.
By the way, speaking of Arianna Huffington, and then we're going to take a break and talk about Bill Cosby.
We'll take a nap and then talk about Cosby.
Nobody's gonna wake up for it.
We're gonna bring it down a notch and talk about multiple rape.
Well, I do want to talk about multiple rape. I want to indulge me because I want
that to, line you hear on every Feldman show. I do want to talk about multiple rape.
I saw a documentary last
By the way,
night.
You don't want to be a rapist on stage, embarrassing the rapists in the audience because they'll remove you from power.
That's why Vince Champ isn't around anymore.
Vince Champ. Yes. Vince Champ was a Vince Champ was a rapist.
Ironically, he was a champ at it. I mean, he was really smart about it.
And he was a comedian.
Yes.
And they were able to trace the rape victims.
He was a serial rapist who did stand-up comedy. And for some reason I'm keeping his name alive. That's why.
I've never heard of him.
Yeah,
never heard of
he
Vince
was
Champ. No, and I'm surprised considering this Cosby thing, wouldn't dig that name back up.
You know, it's true. Like, a lot of people talk about Cosby, but the hipster comedians talk about Vince Champ.
I was raped by Vince Champ before anyone was getting raped by Bill Cosby.
You know, Myka, that's really weird because as an aspiring rapist, I would assume you would have studied up on your history.
Well, Vince Champ was African-American and Bill Cosby is African American. They're very similar because while they were raping you.
Wait, now that they're rapists, can't we just call them black? Or
their race had nothing to do with their rape. Like, you know, the same way the stand-up, it was just they did stand-up like a white man. They raped like a white
man.
Also,
they both kept their language very clean while they were doing
it. Yes, absolutely.
You know, just, you know, they were like, oh, just lie there.
And that's true about Vince Champ was a clean comedian.
He was. He was a clean corporate
comedian.
Those
are the ones you have to watch out for.
Why?
I don't know, because I think it's the same reason why, radically religious people are the ones you have to worry about who are going to go crazy and rape people.
There's no cleaner cop than one on the take.
That isn't what I meant, but...
the cop who is polite and... asks for your, you know, can I come into your house? Do you mind? I don't have a warrant. The one who is really polite is the one who is in the pocket of the mafia. The dirtiest cops are the most polite.
Okay.
And the cleanest comics are the dirtiest.
Yeah, the cleanest comics are the ones who are probably all serial rapists. Why am I saying such horrible things?
That's why you always got to put a rape joke in your act. You know, it's a defense mechanism.
I want to talk very briefly. Give me 2 minutes to talk about Arianna Huffington, then you can respond to this. There's a movie called Open Secret. Alex Brazel, can you look up the movie Open Secret? It's a documentary that I saw last night with our friend, and it is about pedophilia in Hollywood. And they name names. And
the children's names.
Well, pedophilia is rampant in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm. Were you able to finish watching it after you ejaculated, or did you have to turn it off?
And the reason, listen, I ordered.
I wish I could bottle the look on David's face.
No,
when I said
ordered
that.
Buttered popcorn, and they didn't give me. There was no butter in my popcorn. Right. And I figured instead of going back and making a scene and being a Shonda, being the Jew who complains about I paid for the buttered and you didn't give me the. You jerked off.
You cut a hole in the popcorn tub in the bottom and you gave it to the kid sitting next to you.
No, I buttered my popcorn the best way I know how. And so this is a movie about, it's called Open Secret. Am I correct, Alex?
An Open Secret.
By the way, if it's that buttery and salty, you might have diabetes. You might want to check that out.
Okay. Is it Amy Berg? We should book the director. Yes. Amy Berg. I want her on the show. This is a bold documentary about... I had no idea.
You know what? Forget the director. Just get the kids.
Okay, so they bring these kids pose for 8x10s, right?
Right.
These photographers
right.
in the movie. And then their 8x10s are being sold on eBay for like $350. It is really grotesque. And
these are nude photos?
Were they shirtless photos? Of, you know, the parents agreed to let their kids pose. They need 8x10s, and there's this.
I saw the Jack and Triumph casting breakdown. I know what you're talking about.
Yes. So, by the way, on the Jack and Triumph show, Jack plays an ex-child star who is a victim of all this. We do draw attention to.
I don't want to reveal how old I am, but those kind of pictures were taken of me by Matthew Brady. Was the
Those were daguerreotypes.
Yes, they were.
You had to stay perfectly still for a very long. Mm-hmm. So some of the names mentioned.
Frank had them taken by Lewis Carroll. I don't want to say how old he is.
Okay. This is what is implied in the movie. I am now, if you want to sue me, if Arianna Huffington wants to sue me, I am reporting what is in this movie. Okay? What the movie implies is that there are billionaires in Hollywood who financed about 15 years ago an internet movie company for the sole purpose of having parties with underage boys and sitting naked in hot tubs with them. Mm-hmm. And there were financiers in Hollywood who invested in this company. Mm-hmm. I believe the name of the company was Den. And they were running videos on the internet when there was just dial-up, which meant nobody could see these movies. Mm. So it was all about making the movies with the young boys.
So it was a terrible investment.
It was a terrible investment unless you were a billionaire.
And what part did Arianna Huffington play in
all this? Okay. Mm. So one of the investors was Michael Huffington.
Right, her gay former husband.
Now just before you're gonna give a history lesson, but let me point out, because this is really important to me. Mm-hmm. Homosexuality is not pederasty.
No, right.
It is not. We always think that that pederasts are gay. No, they are predators and rapists. What did I say? I'm being serious.
I thought you meant we were saying that about gay people.
But. Well, no, because they don't want gay people teaching and because they're pederasts. Right. No, pederasts.
People like Josh Duggar have spoken out against gay people because they could be pederasts.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Arianna Huffington, who has sold the Huffington Post to AOL and then Verizon and pocketed
tens of millions,
hundreds
of
millions,
yes,
without paying
her bloggers
her bloggers
or her child porn models.
Well, we're going to get to that in a second.
No, they got scale.
She was a Republican. She ran.
She was.
Tell us who Michael Huffington is, Frank.
Michael Huffington was a congressman in California, extremely wealthy, a right-wing Republican.
Oil money.
Yeah, I didn't know where the money was. But Arianna Huffington, who in the 90s or early 90s was a well-known right-wing Republican, and she married him.
She wrote the contract with America for Newt Gingrich?
She's very involved with right-wing politics, and she married Michael Huffington. He ran for governor, I think at the time was the most expensive, the most money anyone had spent on a state race. He lost.
He ran for Senate. He was running for Senate in 1994, and you know how the Republicans in 2004 put gay marriage on the ballot?
Uh-huh.
So people would come and vote against gay marriage,
right,
and then stay and vote for George W. Bush. The issue on the ballot that Arianna and Michael Huffington were pushing was denying health, Social Security health benefits to the children of illegal aliens, illegals, undocumented workers in California. They were basically saying, let undocumented workers and their children die and not get educated. That's how Arianna Huffington ran her husband for Senate in 1994. That's who Arianna Huffington is.
Yes.
Go on.
And he was he ran for Senate, or I thought it was governor, but maybe it was Senate, and he lost, but he was extremely wealthy. They divorced. She got a lot of money in the divorce. And then she, for whatever reason, in the late 90s, she reinvented herself as a left-wing person.
Mm-hmm.
And then
there's more money there,
I guess. And she did a lot, actually, to help when she became supposedly left-wing. She actually did a lot to help George W. Bush get elected, because she was a big advocate in the year 2000 of don't vote for Gore or Bush. They're both part of the same corrupt system. Vote for a third, you know, she had that convention or whatever it was, like vote for a third party. Don't vote for Gore is the same as Bush. And so she, you know, as a lot of, as some left-wing people did, they help Bush get elected.
Now, in the movie, it's called An Open Secret. Is that the name of the movie, Alex, that I saw last night?
Oh, An Open Secret.
An Open Secret.
Yeah.
In the movie, Michael Huffington is named as...
Oh, I forgot to mention that after they divorced and he was out of office, he came out as a gay man.
He came out of the closet
as
a gay man. Arianna Huffington's husband.
Mm-hmm.
And they had two kids together.
Right.
And I'm not so sure Michael Huffington is gay after seeing this movie. Because Arianna Huffington's husband, Michael Huffington, who came out as gay, in the movie is revealed as an investor in this child porn ring. And there is video in this movie
of him eating Subway sandwiches.
Yes. By the way, I lost weight using Jared Fogel's.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I gave all my candy away to kids. It's amazing. If you give away all your candy the way Jared Fogel does to kids and you don't eat it,
right,
you will lose so much weight.
Right.
I wouldn't touch a Subway sandwich. Apparently, with kids, he liked the 6 inches as opposed to a foot long.
Right.
It doesn't like grown men.
You know, it's disillusioning. I just turned to Ronald McDonald's into fisting.
Who do you think has killed more? Who do you think has killed more people? Ronald McDonald or John Wayne Gacy? Which clown? John Wayne Gacy dressed up as a clown and killed people. Who has murdered more children?
Ronald McDonald. I agree with that.
Anyway, let me just get back to Arianna Huffington.
Never mind. Go ahead.
Let me just get back to Arianna Huffington, who was married to Michael Huffington.
By the way, John Wayne Gacy referred to his jizz as a happy meal.
By the way, the other thing about John Wayne Gacy, because he lived in Chicago,
right,
or near Chicago, right, which the coldest winters,
yes,
the insulation. I don't know. I used to stay with him.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The insulation of that house, and he never. I don't know. It was amazing. It was just like it stayed warm all.
Yeah.
I think he had roof rats.
Because
there was always this rumbling sound.
He knew how to keep his heating costs down.
Arianna Huffington was married to Michael Huffington, who I don't think is gay. Because in this movie, An Open Secret? What's it called?
An Open Secret.
An Open Secret. It is in this. I'm just reporting this. So if you want to sue me, go ahead. But I'm just reporting what I saw in this documentary. Michael Huffington, along with David Geffen, they're named as investors in what is essentially a production company.
Oh, David Geffen, really?
Is named as an investor.
He called it Creamworks, I believe.
As an investor in this movie studio, which, according to this movie, was really set up as a way to throw parties and put young boys, and I'm talking about 15-year-old, 14-year-old boys, naked in hot tubs. Mm-hmm. Michael Huffington is named as one of the investors, and there is video. Not of Michael Huffington's face, but of somebody welcoming Michael Huffington to a party for young boys. So he's not on, you don't see his face, but the host is saying, and there's Michael Huffington. And if this is true, it suggests that Arianna Huffington, because a pederast, you don't suddenly become a pederast. You are a pederast.
The second you're too old, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You're either a kid or a pederast.
So it suggests that Arianna Huffington is keeping a secret and should
She's a 15-year-old boy.
Well, no, that there are, that she probably is aware that some felonies were committed by her ex-husband, and she didn't report them.
If what they say is true, and
they're afraid to go that extra step in the movie.
Right.
But it's implied that Michael Huffington, Arianna Huffington's husband, went to boy parties. That's what's implied in this movie, and we'll have the director on. And that's a movie worth seeing.
And you don't think he's gay? You think being a pederast is different than being, like, can't he be gay?
That's a fact.
Right.
That's a fact.
Can't he be a gay pedophile?
Yeah.
No. There's no such thing.
But if he's only into guys?
Screw it. Pederasts are only into children.
Okay.
And
so he might not go to hell because he's not gay. He's just a pederast.
Exactly.
Like, legally, he could, you know, marry one of these kids and be okay.
Right.
And all I know is next year's Kids' Choice Awards are going to be something else.
Mr. Pickle from Nickelodeon is a registered sex offender.
Who's Mr. Pickle?
He's a character on Nickelodeon.
I think they should have known by the name.
Yes.
Exactly.
I think he was open about that.
Anyway, definitely worth seeing. Bill Cosby.
On a lighter note.
Everybody kept their mouths shut.
Because except his dates, but anyway.
It's hard to talk when you're asleep, David.
Is there finally probable cause? I'm sorry, I'm writing headlines for the New York Post. Is it now? I mean, CAA, my agency, finally dropped Bill Cosby.
Well, he's, you know, obviously he's finished as a perform, you know, I don't think he's ever going to do gigs again. Maybe he'll try to, but
well, he won't really be finished until the audience is
asleep. But if he did what he's being accused of doing, he's gotten off easy because he's not in jail.
Right.
He already got off pretty easy.
Yeah,
it wasn't
easy. He had to go through a whole thing where he had to drug the woman and get her to pass out and everything.
How did he get his hands on Quaaludes?
It was the '70s, and he was a star.
And it was 2005.
Oh, really?
Didn't they stop making Quaaludes?
Yeah, they did.
Except in like foreign countries, they would make black market Quaaludes.
I thought the testimony was 2005, but he was still speaking about a time when Quaaludes existed.
But the thing is Malcolm Jamal Warner had a great connection. And oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say that about Malcolm Jamal Warner.
Has he come out against Cosby yet?
I don't know. I think if you were on the Cosby Show, you totally should be coming out against him because you're not getting residuals anymore.
Right. Yeah.
Do you think that's why Felicia Rashad
has been defending him?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, Whoopi Goldberg is still defending him, so.
How is that?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, let's be honest. Cosby's not going to rape Whoopi Goldberg. She's black. She's safe.
Have you seen her lately? You need an elephant dart to put her out.
Oh. But I am. I'm mad at her. I'm not going to see her next movie when it comes out.
Yeah, I stopped watching The View.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't have lost my virginity had it not been for Quaaludes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I screwed a Quaalude.
You lost your virginity to Cosby.
No, I made love to an actual roarer 714. No, I mean, I could
Kim
not.
Kim Fowley gave him Quaaludes.
Who?
Kim Fowley. Oh, there was a whole, never mind. You know, I just made incredibly.
Who?
He was the former manager of the Pretenders. And a whole story came out that he raped the bassist for the Pretenders.
No, for the Runaways. Jett, right?
I'm sorry. No, it was. Sorry, Jett. You're right. The Runaways, not the Pretenders. But he raped a bassist for the Runaways at a Hollywood party in front of a room full of people, including Joan Jett, right?
Yeah, that's and, the accusation.
And the way he did it was he kept feeding this girl Quaaludes till she passed out. Mm-hmm. So anyway, that was my hilarious and Kim Fowley joke explained.
And Joan Jett is remaining mum on this? What is she?
She's claiming she wasn't there, but witnesses at the party say she was.
Well, they're complicit too, the witnesses.
Well, that's what they're saying. You know. They're saying, holy shit. Well, a lot of them were like 15-year-old girls who at the time who are speaking out now, you know?
Oh, okay.
Like they didn't, you know, and this guy was in his 30s and he was a Svengali type for this band of little
girls.
Right,
wasn't he played by Michael Shannon in the movie about the Runaways?
Yeah.
That had the girl from Twilight play Joan Jett, right?
I don't know about that.
But we all turn a blind eye to something when there's money involved, don't we?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because part of the whole Cosby scandal is all of the people who covered up for him for years and didn't encourage people to not come forward and to be quiet. You know, those people failed at test of morality at the time because it was all for money, you know.
It's bigger than money. It's a race issue too. You know, he was like the poster boy for, you know, being this great black American and nobody wanted to ruin that. And I think like that's still like a big part of that issue why people still aren't like Whoopi still isn't. I think that's why.
So Hannibal Buress, did I pronounce his last name properly? Yeah. Buress.
I think so.
Buress. Hannibal Buress.
Buress, yeah.
Would we know about Cosby if I talked about the Jewish community, how they disciplined their own, was that an example of the black?
Yes, there's also a big black conspiracy too.
Is that an example of that of blacks disciplining their own?
I don't think so.
Would we be going after Cosby had Hannibal not brought this
up? That's a really weird thing. That's a really weird aspect of this whole thing.
Did we get permission from Hannibal?
Yeah, yes. It seems that way. And that's a bizarre thing that it took a man saying that this happened to make it a big issue, as opposed to all the women who said that it happened to them, and they and nobody really took them that seriously.
I mean, that's only part of the equation. The other part is like the online community, that this information was like available, that the news story surfaced in the 90s when it could be easily quieted down, you know, it just hits a news cycle and then it's gone. Yeah. You can't fester, you can't do your own research. It's not just that Hannibal said it, it's that someone videotaped it and put it up and it became an online news cycle.
Well, it's also because there's been this Philadelphia independent newspaper that's been beating this drum for years about the Cosby story and really just like doing stories about it and not letting it die. And then they're the ones who put the Hannibal video on their website. And that's what gave the rest of the media permission to cover it, because they were the first to put it up there.
I have to stop. What we're going to do is we're going to wrap up the show and then come back for some premium content.
Right.
So for the people who are not going to go,
that's
for
what we're saving Cosby. Our good rape jokes for.
If you want to enjoy our premium content, we're going to talk about Jared from Subway and child porn, the Confederate flag being taken down, South Carolina.
I can hear the PayPal going crazy right now.
Keith Olbermann, we're going to do some gossiping about Al Gore and current TV.
Oh, okay,
Keith Olbermann getting dumped by ESPN, how Manhattan is sucking all the money from the rest of the country into Manhattan, George Bush charging wounded veterans charity $100,000 for a speech. We'll talk about that. French taxi drivers overturning an Uber vehicle. Jeb Bush, Jason Pierre Paul, Greece, China stock market, a tornado in Venice, and the big story, Amy Schumer, should she have apologized for making Mexican jokes? If you're not going to do our premium content, which you can get by becoming a monthly subscriber for as little as $5 a month, I want to thank you for listening. Tell your friends to listen to our podcast. Let's go around the table and plug some gigs. Liam McEneaney.
I'll be in Huntington, Long Island tonight. So if you're listening to this live, you can definitely check it out. I'll be at the UCB Theater this Thursday, the 16th. And I have a podcast called Tell Your Friends, and that's all I can announce.
It's good to see you, buddy.
Good to see you too, bro.
Myka Fox, Fox and Friends. Myka Fox and Friends is your podcast.
That's right.
Watch Saturday Night Live to see your jokes.
Sure.
You're a very funny writer. And how else can people get in touch with you?
I have another podcast called This Week in Jacking, where we ask people what they masturbate from the first time they got a nut off to the most recent in search engine history, and that's on the...
God, and David already just went through all his material about that movie he saw.
And by the way, I'm a guest on that show. It's already gone down in history as the longest podcast episode ever.
Wait a second.
In fact, it's never actually finished.
What is the name of this podcast?
It's called This Week in Jackin. I host it with comedian Chris Laker, very funny guy, and
it's people talking about what they masturbate.
Yeah, it's one of the few unspoken topics people talk about masturbation, right, but not specifically what's going on in their mind. And I think there's a lot of
it's
jack
good you're
shaming
doing,
that we're trying to.
It's good you're doing something so commercial.
Okay,
really help your career by something that people can really.
Hey man, kids are killing themselves because they're embarrassed about masturbating. I think we're doing a public service.
Right. Okay, so I just want to. If you
I don't think
listen,
anyone's ever killed themselves.
If you want to listen to our premium content coming up, we're going to be talking about Myka Fox's podcast. The other stuff we're not going to be talking about. I got everything wrong. Nobody told me that you do an entire show about masturbation, which as opposed to my show, which is just an exercise of masturbation.
And at least you're getting some exercise.
Frank Conniff?
I can be heard every day on SiriusXM, channel 121 from 2 to 5 on the John Fugelsang, Tell Me Everything with John Fugelsang, and Cartoon Dump, my show, is the first of every month, the first Monday of every month at QED in Queens. And
people have to follow you on Facebook.
Follow me on Facebook and Twitter, Frank Conniff. And also,
I'm going to just put in a plug and say I did Frank's show this month, and it was great.
Like Cartoon Dump.
One of the best shows in New York City, hands down.
It's really, Mike has been in it.
Agreed.
And but now that we're not estranged anymore, you could be in it now, too. I hope so. I hope you'll be in it.
David's a regular at QED.
Yes.
Yeah. And also, you can go to Frank Conniff. com and find my podcast, Podhouse 90, which I do one episode a year of because it's original scripted radio plays that I write.
Mm-hmm.
So Podhouse 90.
But you have to follow Frank on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to.
Facebook or Twitter, it's the same.
And the Mystery Science Theater guys, you're touring, but...
Oh, Trace Blue, you and I are starting to go out. We did a show in Denver about a month ago where the two of us riff on a movie. We did the Ed Wood movie, Glenn or Glenda. And we did an atheist convention where we did the movie God's Not Dead, which was really, it's the worst movie ever made. And so, but we don't have any of those gigs lined up, but we will soon. So watch.